Hi, I'm Derek, and this is DC to Daylight. In this episode, we're going to take a look at a handful of op-amp circuits, 8 to be exact. Now, in the previous episode, we looked at the inverting, non-inverting, and comparator. We also looked under the hood in an op-amp. If you want a little more of a detailed explanation of what's going on, click the link above and you can get to that previous episode. So this video is really just going to be a cursory overview of all these circuits and the basic formulas, how to use them, and what values in the neighborhood you should be using to make the op-amp circuit do what it needs to do. No proofs, fancy derivations. We'll leave that to the textbook. This is more of a practical application approach, just showing you how to use the thing. So we're going to look at the inverting amplifier, the non-inverting amplifier, a comparator, peak detector, summing amplifier, difference amplifier, and we'll throw in for good measure the clipper and clamper circuit. So let's not spend any more time talking about it. Let's get right into it. So the first circuit on our list is the inverting amplifier. In this amplifier, we have basically two resistors. We have a feedback resistor that forms our closed loop system. We're feeding the output back to the non-inverting input. And we have an input resistance that goes to the inverting terminal. The non-inverting terminal is connected directly to ground. Now, in this particular circuit, the ratio of the feedback resistor to the input resistor is proportional to the voltages involved. So the gain of the system is negative because it's an inverting amp. The output is 180 degrees out of phase with the input. So the feedback resistor divided by the input resistance is equal to your gain. So let's breadboard that circuit and we'll take a look at it on the scope. So for all experiments today, we're gonna be using the TL072 from Texas Instruments. Much better performance than the LM741. And has a low noise JFET for an end. I've already set up my power supply here. I have positive 12 going to pin 8. I have a negative 12 volts going to the negative supply here on pin 4. And you'll see the bare wires are connected to ground, which is halfway between that supply. Some op amps need a dual supply, some only require a single supply. In this case, I'm using a dual just for simplicity's sake, okay? So I have bare wires here that are ground. And I have decoupling capacitors going from the positive rail to ground and the negative rail to ground. You should actually use these at all times because they shunt noise to ground and it's often omitted from schematics. So pin 1 is the output, pin 2 is the inverting input, and pin 3 is non-inverting. So the non-inverting input in this case is connected to ground. I'm going to use a 10K resistor for my inverting input to my signal source here coming from my function generator. Now I'm gonna use a feedback resistor of 47 kilo ohms. So my gain is 4.7. If I have a half a volt in, 0.5 times 4.7, my output voltage should be 2.35 volts. So over at the scope, you can see I have my half a volt peak to peak signal here. And when I turn the op amp on, I should see 2.35. And in fact, we're measuring 2.38. And you'll notice that the phase is 180 degrees out of phase with the input. So the blue trace is my output, yellow is my input, and they are flipped 180 degrees out of phase. So that is the inverting op amp.
The second circuit we're going to look at today is the non-inverting amplifier. Now, as the name implies, the phase of the output is in phase with the input signal. There's no inversion. So we drive the non-inverting pin directly with our signal. And at the output, we have a voltage divider, two resistors, and we tap off the center of those resistors and feed it back into the inverting input. Now, what's unique about the non-inverting amplifier is that the gain is, of course, the ratio of R2 over 1, just like the previous one, but there's no phase inversion, so there's no negative sign. But we do have to add plus 1, and that's the way the math works out. And I'm not getting into the math like I said, but it's 1 plus R2 over R1. That 1 means that the gain can never be less than 1, whereas the inverting amplifier, we could actually use it as an attenuator. All that being said, let's go over to the breadboard and we'll actually measure it.
Now let's reconfigure this op amp as a non-inverting circuit. We're going to use our 47K as our feedback resistor, which goes from pin 1 to 2. And remember, we're forming a voltage divider, so from pin 2, I'm going to use a 10K resistor going to ground, which we do there. Now we're gonna feed the input at pin 3, okay? Remember, the gain is the ratio of those two resistors, but we have to add 1 because we're using this voltage divider here. Recall that 47 kilo ohms divided by our 10 kilo ohms is equal to 4.7 plus 1. Our gain is 5.7, and we're going to multiply that by the 500 millivolts that we're inputting, so times 0.5. We should see 2.85 volts
peak to peak on the scope. So we see that we're in phase. The output has the same phasing as the input. And down here, we actually measure 2.9. So, our scope isn't 100% accurate. I trust a voltmeter better than this, but you can see that we have a gain of 2.85, close to 3.
The third circuit we're going to look at today is the comparator. And as the name implies, we're comparing two voltages at the inputs of the op-amp. Now, we need a reference voltage to compare it to. So in our case, we're going to use a voltage divider, and we're going to connect it to the inverting pin of the op-amp. Now, you could use any kind of semiconductor specialized device to set up a voltage reference, or you could use a diode, a Zener diode, something to create a stable voltage to compare our input signal against. Now, when our input voltage gets above our reference voltage, the output simply slams high. Okay, when our input voltage is less than our reference voltage, the output slams low. Pretty simple. Let's see that thing in action on the bench.
All right, so this is our comparator circuit. So I have a voltage divider that acts as a reference going to our inverting pin, and attached to our non-inverting pin is the center wiper of this potentiometer. So as I turn this, I can change the voltage on the non-inverting pin. The op amp is going to compare that varying voltage against our fixed voltage here, which is only a couple of volts below our negative rail. So we'll look at it on the scope, and you'll see as I vary this potentiometer, I'm changing the voltage, and it'll kind of pass over and under that reference voltage. So the output pin will be monitoring as well, and I have it connected to a couple of LEDs. So as I'm above my reference voltage, we'll go green. If I'm below it, we'll turn red, okay? Because these LEDs are flipped in opposite polarities. Let me turn this on. And we'll monitor our potentiometer using this probe. And we'll monitor the output of the op amp using this probe. So over at the scope, I have my reference voltage, okay, which is just like a volt or so above the negative rail. And then I've got my blue trace. So as I vary my potentiometer, I can go over and under that, right? So the op amp's gonna compare these two and give us a certain output. So back over on our breadboard, if I'm above that reference voltage, I'm green. And as I decrease my potentiometer, as I cross over that threshold, it turns red. Well, it looks orange on camera. All right, I'm gonna go back above and it turns green. Now with this probe right here, we're gonna monitor the output of the op amp. So let me turn that trace on. All right, you can see that we're high because that LED was green. Now if I go below my threshold voltage, the purple trace will go low. All right, so that's what the comparator is doing.
So the fourth circuit that we're going to look at today is called the peak detector. And essentially it's used in audio circuits and anytime you want to grab a signal and hold it high for some period of time, okay? Like driving a VU meter for some kind of audio circuitry, right? The way this thing works is we just drive the op amp with some kind of signal. And at the output of the op amp, we put a diode and that acts as a rectifier, okay? So the output of that rectifier gets fed back into the other terminal of the op amp. So that forms a precision rectifier. Now, if we connect a capacitor to ground, okay, across the output shunted to ground, what we do is when that signal goes high, it charges up that capacitor rather quickly, and then it discharges. So if we're connected to a meter, it can hold that signal high for a period of time, and then we have that natural discharge curve of a RC circuit. Which brings us to another point. If you have a resistor connected across the output of that op amp, it will drain faster. So you really have to pay attention to your RC time constant, okay? Anyway, let's take it to the bench so you can see exactly what I'm talking about.
All right, so the peak detector circuit is actually pretty simple, okay? We have a diode that goes from the output and goes into the non-inverting input. The signal that we want to peak detect, okay, our input signal goes to pin 3, which is our non-inverting input. I've got a probe here that's measuring the output of that diode. On our scope, our yellow trace is our input signal, and the blue trace is the output waveform from that rectifier diode. So, yeah, we've got some undershoot here where the diode's turning on and off. But what we're going to do, we're going to take a 680 picofarad capacitor and we're going to connect it between the output of that diode and ground. And what that's going to do is, well, attempt to smooth out that rectified waveform, right? Just like a regular old rectifier circuit. And you can immediately see on the scope that we start to fill in the gaps here, okay? That capacitor gets charged up and then starts discharging. And that discharge rate is an RC time constant. So if you want to fill in this gap more and hold that peak longer, what you need to do is increase that value of capacitance. So let's change that value of 680 picofarads and we'll change it to 10 nanofarads. Pull this guy out. We'll put this guy in. And there you go. Now you can see what the peak detector is really doing. So we're charging up, we're holding,
charging up, holding. So when I turn that off, you can see we have kind of this sine wave that starts to form. It holds the peak there. We charge it up again, it holds it again. So if I were listening to music, there might be a big bass response, and then it would hold it for a little bit and discharge. All right. And then the next bass peak would come up and we would charge up again. So you've got to know what kind of load you're driving and how the time constant is going to affect that discharge rate. Okay. So that is how a peak detector works.
The fifth circuit we're going to look at today is the summing amplifier, sometimes called a mixer or adder. All right. So in this case, if we're using a non-inverting amplifier, we have multiple resistors at the input and one feedback resistor. Okay. So again, the ratio of the feedback resistor to the input resistors sets the gain of the system. Okay. So typically we'll have the same resistance across all of those input resistors, and the ratio of R2 or R feedback over whatever that input resistance might be sets the gain of the system. So we could take one of those signals, it could be a sine wave, the other signal could be, I don't know, plus 5 volts. And then at the output, you'd have that sine wave shifted up by 5 volts, okay? So you can use it to apply an offset. You can also mix audio signals. In fact, those big mixing boards that you see typically end up going through one of these summing amplifiers, okay? Let's take a look. Okay, here's our summing amplifier. It's basically an inverting configuration, okay? So my input resistors are both going to pin 2, which is my inverting input. And I have my feedback resistor here going from the output back to the inverting input. Just like any inverting amplifier, my non-inverting terminal is connected to ground. All of these resistors are 5.6K, so overall the gain, okay, the closed loop gain is 1. So whatever I see at the input, I should see at the output, but I'm adding these two terminals together. So nothing connected to this terminal, but I have a potentiometer connected to the other input terminal. So let's connect our probe to the output of the op amp and see what we get. So as I turn this potentiometer, you can see that my output voltage from the op amp changes. So what happens if I add a sine wave to this? Well, let's connect a sine wave to the other resistor. And you can see we have a sine wave at the output on our scope. Let me turn on the reference waveform that's actually driving that op amp input. And that's in yellow. Okay, so my function generator driving the op amp is yellow. The output from the op amp is 180 degrees out of phase. As I turn the potentiometer, okay, I go more positive. We're an inverting amplifier, so it drives the sine wave down. We're adding the DC offset from the pot to the sine wave that we're inputting on the other pin. Okay, now I could add another channel, 3, 4, 5 other inputs to this op amp, and we could come up with a really wacky waveform, but I just wanted to show you how we can add two signals together. And there you go, summing amplifier. The sixth circuit that we're going to look at today is called a difference amplifier. So anytime that we have a balanced signal, maybe a long cable run to some sensor, it can pick up a lot of noise. All right. So from RF, anything in the environment like a drill or a motor, the noise will be on that line in phase, okay, on both of those signals. Now we'll have a differential signal along that line that we want to keep. And the difference amplifier, if you have common mode noise on each line and you subtract those signals, the noise essentially goes away. And that's dependent upon the CMRR, or common mode rejection ratio, of the op amp. All right, and that's in your data sheet. The higher the number in dBs, the better it is at getting rid of that noise. All right, and your differential signal will still be there. All right, and this is a pretty cool one. So let's take a look. Here's our differential amplifier circuit. I've got two input resistors that are connected to our inverting input and our non-inverting input, and they each have their own feedback resistors. So we have basically a non-inverting and inverting circuit with feedback resistors that work in concert to subtract the difference between these two input signals. All the values are the same at 5.6K, so it gives us a gain of 1. Now I could have made these feedback resistors equal, and we could introduce gain, but I'm trying to keep things simple here. What I'm going to do is introduce some noise through these capacitors. I'm going to AC couple random noise, and that is going to be common to both inputs. Okay, so we're driving both of these pins at the same time with the same noise at the same phase, and it's connected to each of the input side of these resistors. And I'm running out of scope probes, so we're just going to connect this guy up like this. This guy goes to ground. All right, so let's take a look at that noise. There it is on the screen with the purple trace. It's 3.4 volts peak to peak. And that noise on the other side of the capacitor is going to be superimposed on that sine wave for each of these input legs of the op amp. Now remember, my noise is in phase and these two signals are out of phase. Okay, so we're going to subtract all of that, and what we're going to end up with at the output is hopefully just the sine wave. So it has subtracted out the noise, and this blows me away every time that I see it. It's absolutely amazing that that differential amplifier can subtract out that noise and just leave the sine wave. The seventh circuit that we're going to look at today is called a clipper. So the clipper is an interesting circuit that, well, in my experience, it comes from guitar. Okay, so distortion pedals. It takes your nice clean input from your guitar and it chops off the waveform and makes it sound crunchy and, you know, heavy metal. The other application for clipper circuits is maybe taking a sine wave and squaring it off so that you can measure the frequency, or maybe clipping a circuit before it goes into, I don't know, an Arduino so that you're not damaging the input pins as a ESD protection device, something like that. So anyway, let's look at how that works. All right, so in this case, we're driving our input resistor with our sine wave on this side. And on the other side of this input resistor, we're driving the non-inverting terminal. This diode connects to the output of the op amp, the cathode side anyway. The anode side goes to the non-inverting input along with this resistor. Non-inverting terminal is connected to a voltage reference, which is our potentiometer. Okay, so as we change this potentiometer, we change the reference voltage and where that signal clips. And we're monitoring the output at the anode side of the diode, not at the output of the op amp, but on this side of the diode. Okay, let's see what that waveform looks like. Here's our input waveform in yellow. Let me turn on the output trace. Okay, right on top of that signal. And as I adjust my potentiometer, we change where our clipping occurs. So, neat little circuit. Now, if I wanted to clip the top side and the bottom side of that sine wave, I could cascade a couple of op amps and flip the polarity of this diode, and essentially you'd be able to control both sides with a voltage reference like I'm doing here. So there you go. The last circuit we're going to look at today is called a clamper. Now, the clamper is an interesting circuit that doesn't get a lot of love. Basically, if you have an AC input signal and you want to apply some offset, instead of adding a DC voltage, you can just throw a capacitor in the circuit, and that will provide the DC offset for you. So anyway, interesting circuit. Let's take a look on the breadboard. All right, so here we have our clamper circuit. It's very similar in configuration to the clipper circuit, except we have a capacitor that we're driving, all right? Our input signal is driving one leg of the cap, and the output is being measured across the other side of that cap. We also have a diode, but in this case, the polarity is reversed. So the anode is connected to the output, cathode to the inverting input. The non-inverting input is grounded, all right? So what this thing does is it'll actually lift your input signal up above ground, okay? So it doesn't really provide a variable offset. It lifts that signal to where the bottom part of that, let's say a sine wave, rides along ground and everything is shifted up. Interesting little circuit. So let's look at the scope and we'll turn the op amp on. And you'll see we have our 0 volt reference here, and that sine wave is riding right along top of it, okay? And that's basically how a clamper works. All right, well, that wraps up this episode of Op Amp Applications. My hope with this episode was that by showing you these different circuits and configurations, that it would give you the confidence to build your own op amp circuits if you run across like a sensor or something you need to interface to another device. So it puts it in your mental toolbox and you can use this as a reference. So hopefully it was useful. If it was, let me know down in the comments or hit me up at element14.com in the community. The links are down below. And that is it. I will see you next time.